I will be the first to say that the story is not always a smooth story. As a matter of fact, the story is often mired in the human condition of hate, sin, and evil. Last Sunday, we spent time in the first 11 chapters of Genesis, and it all began with a good creation. And as Adam and Eve enter the scene, their sin banishes them from the garden. One of their sons ends up murdering the other son. God then destroys the earth with a flood and leaves only Noah and his family to start over to repopulate the earth. Today, we look at chapters 12 through 35 of Genesis, and God begins with a different approach, but he uses the same raw material. Human beings. Me, you, us. The very source that has already messed it up twice before. People seem to be the flaw in God's great plan, but God decides to use people to correct the flaw. And out of nowhere comes Abram, the son of Terah, and while a nomadic people, he and his family spent most of their life in Mesopotamia, particularly Haran, living, I would imagine, from what I read, a fairly comfortable, well-established, somewhat nomadic, settled life. Now, the book, the story, in its timeline, puts the birth of Abram at about 2166 B.C., well over 2,000 years before Christ. And from what we know in the book of Genesis, for 75 years, Abram's life mirrored and learned from the generation and generations before him. But at age 75, he receives a call from God, a call from Yahweh, to travel to Canaan and build a great nation. Talk about a second career. Talk about coming out of retirement. Talk about shaking his family structure to the core. But what I find even more amazing than even the call is that there is no evidence, now please get this, there is no clear, complete, concrete evidence that Abram ever knew of this God called Yahweh. Please let that settle in for a moment. It could be reasonably argued that Abram would have been practicing the religions of his local community, the polytheist adoration of many different gods. Even Joshua, as he talks to his people following the death of Moses, says this, and I'll quote Joshua, quote, "Long ago, your forefathers, including Terah, the father of Abraham, lived beyond the river and worshipped other gods." Think about that. But another interesting slant on the call of Abram is recognized by Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann as it deals with the barrenness of Sarah. He presents the theory that perhaps their barrenness went beyond being childless, that their safe and comfortable life had become barren, meaningless, void of purpose, and empty. Now, assessing that idea, we begin to see that perhaps God and what the authors of the story describe and define as the upper story, God's story, you know, the story that goes beyond our human understanding, uses the right circumstances And what they refer to as the lower story, people, us, the muck and the mire that we live in, becomes apparent that God truly sees Abram and Sarai as truly the ones to restore God's intended creation. And what unfolds throughout the next 23 chapters, I believe, is a story that articulates, defines, and virtually demonstrates to us today the essence of faith. What does it take? Through Abraham and Sarah, we are called to integrate the story of faith. Let me explain. I believe that all faith must begin first and foremost with a promise from a promise maker. You know, we do it all the time. When we talk to one another, when families or people in church talk, and we gather together to receive information, or we communicate knowledge, almost across the board, our first response is, "Who said so? Who told you that? Where'd you get that information? Where on the internet can I find the source of what you're telling me?" Here, Abram is offered a promise of a great nation, of countless blessings, from the promise maker, the one and only God, Yahweh. It would have been absolutely foolish for Abram to trust a doubtful promiser. Something happened there in that moment that he put complete trust in perhaps the God he knew nothing about. Before us today is the question, who is my promise maker? Whose banner do I supremely and ultimately trust? It has been said by scholars and theologians that within Holy Scripture are over 30,000 promises God makes to God's people. Think about that for a minute. You open up the Bible, and within the covers of that Bible are over 30,000 promises God makes. Wouldn't it make sense that as we go through the story, as you go through your Bible, that we might be able to find a few promises that we can hang our hat on, a few promises that we can hang our lives on? But faith also requires a pilgrimage, a journey toward fulfilling the promise. Now, as I was putting my thoughts together for this week, I was reminded that most especially in our United Methodist tradition, we are born to move. We as United Methodists, we're on the move all the time. We're constantly on our way, always progressing toward the kingdom. And I find great serenity that as we do that, as we journey, as we are on our pilgrimage, just like Abram, we journey in stages. As a matter of fact, older translations say exactly that. Abram journeyed on by stages, which incorporates the understanding that we are marching toward a marathon and not dashing toward a sprint. Faith calls us on a continual journey, and my friends, the island of "I've made it" is only a respite towards what is next. Every stage in our journey toward the promise is indeed fraught with challenges and hopes and dreams, but friends, they're all taken one stage at a time. But might I give one warning as we journey? And that is to understand that perfect outcomes, may not always be the will of God, and great difficulties do not mean that God has forsaken us. How many times when we have a game plan, oh, we've got a vision, we've got a dream, we've got pie charts, we got bar graphs, we got it all connected, and things go swimmingly beautiful, and point A takes you to B, and it spits you out to an end result, and we get excited and we say to each other, boy, that worked out so great, it must have been the will of God. Or it's bad theology. No matter the promise, however resolute our journey, faith always requires one more thing. And that is the presence of God in our lives. Along his journey toward the promise, Abram, we are told in Scripture in these 23 chapters, is that he constantly set up altars along the way for the promise maker. The altar was a symbol of his trust in God and a sign to the world that he completely trusted the one God of creation. The altar symbolized that God's presence was with him. And here we are, 4,000 plus years later, the altar does the same for us. Our altar, our worship, reminds us of God's presence. And at times we praise at the altar. At times we pray at the altar. At times we cry at the altar. At times we offer ourselves at the altar. At times we baptize. At times we break bread and share the cup. All of those are reminders that God is with us. That is why worship is the center of our pilgrimage. Worship is the center of our journey. Oh, it's wonderful to gather together on Sunday morning to catch up with each other, have a cup of coffee, and enjoy the fellowship. But friends, first and foremost, we gather to worship God, the promise maker, who on our journey is always present. I end with this, and it's a story you may have heard, but it's a story from Yugoslavia that talks about the four angels who created, or who witnessed the creation. And I want to share it with you. It says this: the first angel observed God's handiwork in awe and said, "Lord, your creation is beautiful. How did you do that?" That's the worldview of a scientist. The second angel observed in awe and said, "Lord, your creation is beautiful. Why did you do that?" That is the worldview of a philosopher. The third angel observed in awe and said, "Lord, your creation is beautiful. Can I have it?" That's the worldview of a materialist. But finally, the fourth angel observed in awe and said, "Lord, your creation is beautiful. Can I help?" That is the worldview of God's faithful. In light of Abraham's faith, the question before us rests, I believe, in the words of that fourth angel. As we turn to God this morning, our call is to ask God, in my journey, in my pilgrimage, can I help in building your kingdom alongside you? Let us pray. Wonderful and gracious God, you have given us a promise. Oh, and you have given us many promises. And as we journey together, using our different gifts and graces, talents, apprehensions, doubts, and fears. Your promise has always been that you will be with us every breath of the way. Lord God, as we learn from Abram and Abraham, Sarai and Sarah, as we learn from their promise, their pilgrimage, as we learn of your presence with them, may it be ours every breath of the way. In your holy name we pray. Amen.